He was saying to forgive him that hurts you, despitefully use you. That says right there, because you are clean in his eyes, God says. And God says that he's going to use you many, many great things.
Yeah, yeah.
There's so many things that God is
going to
do. Yeah. Yes, Lord. And I believe that that. I heard God say there's a lot of prophets that prophesy to you.
Yeah.
Alright now. Father, in the name of Jesus. One thing I learned is this, is that I don't move unless he moves, because if I'm moving without him moving, it's witchcraft.
Yeah, alright.
It's witchcraft simply because you can't control God. God is sovereign. He does what he wants to do. He moves when he wants to move. The Bible says in Isaiah 43, he says, there is no God beside me.
That's right.
He says that I'm God alone.
Yes.
He says, who will be able to deliver you from my hand? There is nobody greater than God.
That's right.
So when it comes down to God, I'm like this. I don't even want to get in your way. I don't want to get in your way. I never want to get in God's way. Because God gets all the glory. He gets all the honor.
That's right.
He's the one that paid the price.
Yeah.
He's the one. It was Jesus. Not you and I that did it, but Jesus.
Come on. Thank you, Jesus.
I don't want for people to look at me. I want for them to look at him.
Yeah.
I want for them to look at you. We're living in the last days.
Amen.
We're living in the days of Noah. Mm-hmm. Where he said there was going to be floods. Not only floods, but preacher giving up their buildings, quitting preaching. God said that there was going to be the days of Noah. You must understand, in the days of Noah, the Bible says that, he says, just as the days of Noah, you must understand that the days of Noah, the preacher closed the door and there was nobody else save us of him and his family. I want to ask you tonight, how many of you, when God called you home, are you going to be able, truly, say that I'm ready. God says you're a jewel. Let it go, God says. Say, just let it go. Let it go. Don't worry about it. Let it go.
Shock.
Did you know that? Did you know if you go to a fortune teller, they can tell you what you ate last night? It don't mean that they are of God.
That's true.
A lot of times people, they go and they say, you know, well, the prophet said that I was wearing a yellow shirt. He prophesied real good. Well, that's not prophecy. That's word of knowledge. Word, check this out. Word of knowledge. God saying that I know you. That's what word of knowledge is. It's simplicity. I know you. That's what God says. I know you. That's our word of knowledge. Word of wisdom is giving insight on an event to come. Give you insight on something that you normally couldn't do. And it ties down with prudence. The word prudence means to settle someone's future. Take an instance, 12 years later, I want a date. And you write down the plans and the ideals of how you want to do it. That's what you call prudence. God says, according to all the wisdom and prudence. What does that mean? That means that God is God all in all. He never allowed for you to be in a place what we call voidness. I want for us to go to Ephesians real fast. Am I boring you? The Bible says that this word should be in your heart. That word is really spirit. It should be in your spirit, not in your intellect, but in your spirit. Jesus said it like this. He said, many have the word by the wayside. That's your mind. God don't want it for it to be just in your mind. Because if in your mind, somebody can steal it. Somebody can come and step on your toe. You forget all about that word. You done cussed them out. Come on. Let's tell the truth. But Jesus forgive me. Come on. Now y'all are bona fide, dude. Come on. Y'all got a license to sin now because somebody stepped on your toe. But God says, he says in Ephesians, the 3rd chapter. I want for you to go to Ephesians 3. Because I was reading this, and I was like, my God, God, you are awesome. You are amazing.
Yes, he is.
He said, for this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for you Gentiles, if indeed you have heard of the dispensation. Dispensation means a particular time. Say, for instance, at 5 o'clock, I decide to eat my lunch. That's what dispensation covers. It's a particular time. Or at 7 o'clock, I got a date. The child died. Elijah burst out and said, the Lord hid this from me. You know what you really said? He's a prophet. But he don't know everything. Just because you're a prophet don't mean that you know everything. Don't mean that you keep in the spirit. And if God revealed it, you don't know it.
That's it.
So, Ephesians 3. What I want for people to understand, it's not really called hitting and missing, what people call it. It's really called being human.
What?
Because it's not biblical. What have you read in the scripture where it says it's called hitting and missing? That's just the term that we came up with. Just like we say, you can come as you are. That ain't biblical. Come on now. So, it says in Ephesians 3, for this reason I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for you Gentiles, if indeed you have heard of the dispensation of the grace. Watch. Now, catch that. Jesus died. But when the Holy Ghost came, he said, I'm going to leave a comforter. Why? Because Peter said it like this. You are kept by the power of God and not by yourself. So what does that mean? That means that God sent a helper, as the Bible says. And Psalms 46 and 1, he says that the Lord is a present help in a time of trouble. The Bible let us know that a man that's born of a woman is of a few days born. Come on, sometimes it hits you so fast to the point that you're sinking like Peter. One minute you're walking on water, and the next minute you say, God, how did I get myself in this mess? The truth of the matter is, God says that I have given you a dispensation of grace. What does that mean? That means, come strong now. When the spirit of the Lord kicks in and you do not think it, remember what I said earlier. The Bible says the Holy Ghost prayed for things that you think not of. See, that's what you call the dispensation of grace. Because the truth of the matter is, come on now, if you found out that your child was killed, come on now. If you found out, come on now, that you had one day, come on now, to live, you probably wouldn't be thinking about Jesus. You'd be thinking about all the pain, all the wrongs. You'd probably be thinking about, come on now, is this true? But the truth of the matter is, the Bible says it like this. The Bible says the Holy Ghost, it brings all things back to remembrance. But not just all things back to remembrance, but the Bible says this. The Bible says it brings back the things of God back to remembrance. And the truth of the matter is, it's not you or me, but it's a God thing. I said, I gotta say God thing. God thing, God thing. Come on, if it wasn't for Jesus, come on, the children of Israel say it like this. They say, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, where would I be? The truth of the matter is the reason why. Because they had went through a test. Can I tell you that the Bible let us know that every man is given a measurement of faith. Faith, come on now, comes through trial. The only way God can test your faith is to see you, come on now, and he stands back. This is why the Bible says that he has given you the dispensation of grace. Because grace represents, watch this, power over the enemy. Come on now. Grace represents Jesus being Lord. Come on now. The grace represents Jesus being your advocate with the Father. Grace represents, come on now, Jesus, come on now, being your help. Come on now. Grace represents the power that he has given unto you over the enemy. The truth of the matter is, the Bible says it like this. The Bible says that we had came from iniquity. Come on now. And the Bible says this. We were shaped in iniquity. What did that mean? We were shaped in sin. Why was you shaped in sin? Come on now, because you're, come on now, you're no good. Earthly man, it ain't Adam. Come on now. Ain't that tree that he knew he should name. Come on. And the truth of the matter is, what God says is this. He says, you know, I have given you a dispensation of grace, but don't use this word grace as a permission to sin, because the Bible says that sin should abound. God forbid. What does that mean? That means just because God said he'll forgive you, don't mean that you need to go and smoke that cigarette. Come on now. Oh, I know he get on your nerves, but let's preach it anyway. The truth of the matter is a lot of times we go around and we say, you know what? Well, she did it, he did it, and they got away with it. Well, don't you know the Bible says that God has grace on who he wants to have grace on? Just because they got away with it, don't mean that God will give you the grace. Come on out, the past, the same thing that they went through. The truth of the matter is, he says this, look at us different from one another. Why? Because every man has been given a measurement of faith, and that word faith represents, watch this, his word. Watch this, so what does that mean? The Bible says the world can't receive this. Why can't the world receive this? Because the Bible says, unless you have the Spirit of Christ, you are not the heels. And the truth of the matter is, that means this. That means you're here to give you grace. But he says in 2 Chronicles, if my people, which are called by my name, I gotta say, which are called by my name, what does that mean? That means this. That means that he bought you back with a price. What does that mean? That means that he fought for you. He said, my people, come on out, my people, what does that mean? My people that's going to the club. What does that mean? My people going to the crack house. What does that mean? My people, come on now, which are called by my name. The truth of the matter is, a lot of times we say it's the world that's doing it. But no, baby, it's the church that's doing it. That's what the Bible says in Ephesians. He said that he has given first apostles, prophets, evangelists, and pastors, and teachers. Why? So that we can get this thing called salvation together. He said it was given for the perfection of the saints. Why? Simply because this. Paul said it like this. We are filthy framed together. What does that mean? That means, come on, our righteousness is as filthy rags. But I got some grace for you. The Bible says this. If your heart condemns you, know that God is great. So that means that if you mess up, he says, I'm still perfect. do what he still do. Because he said he'll never leave nor forsake you. How is it that there's a lot of church folk that come to church that say, they still preaching, they still teaching, but I know they ain't no good. I know, come on now. I know that their flesh is nasty. Come on, they probably, come on now, sleeping around. Come on, let's tell the truth. Like the Bible says in 1 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, it said it was tongue-talking preachers. Come on now, sleeping in the bed. Come on now, with people that they have no business sleeping with. Yeah. You can't tell me that the church was messed up. And the truth of the matter is, that's in the first form. That's why you need to stay under good leadership. Because good leadership will tell you when you're wrong. Good leadership is not always your friend, because sometimes they're your enemy because you don't agree with what they say. But you got to do it anyway. The Bible says that he had given this dispensation of grace over to us. A crooked generation. The Bible says a perverse generation. You can't tell me perversion is not on the rise when you got preachers sleeping with little boys. You can't tell me perversion is not on the rise when you got women, come on now, they're showing their cleavage to everybody. You can't tell me that perversion is not on the rise. But God says, I still love you in spite of it all. Because the truth of the matter is, he says that I see your future. I see your potential. See, that's where the word prudence come in. See, the truth of the matter is, the world see your now. But God sees your future. The truth of the matter is, God says this. He says that he's a helper. Come on now. When everybody turn around on you, he said he'd be a friend that's sticking closer than any brother. What did that mean? That means this. That he'll still love you like a family member. But he'll tell you to get your act together. Come on now. The truth of the matter is, who the Lord loves, he chastises. What did that mean? Sometimes, come on now. You want the money. Come on now. You paid the tax. But you forgot that you slipped up last year. Come on now. The truth of the matter is, God has a funny way of saving you. But come on now. Remembering the sin. You remember that old boy David? That sin with Bathsheba. He didn't kill him. He said, no. He said, Nathan, I want you to understand this. That I'm not going to kill him. I'm going to spare him. But I'm going to remember his sin. Come on. You can't tell me that God ain't good like that. But the truth of the matter is, what we do is we come to church and we act like, come on now, simply because we got an office or a title that we better than somebody. Come on now, the truth of the matter is, come on now, you are nasty. Come on now, when, come on now, when you ain't able to do the altar call, you mad. Come on now, when you don't get to sing on the choir, you mad. Why she singing? Why he up singing? Why he up doing testimony service? The truth of the matter is, there ain't no good thing in the flesh. But God says, I still use you in spite of it all. The truth of the matter is, in Isaiah 58, the Bible says God was going to put away the pointing of the finger. I asked God, I said, how are you going to do that? We come on out, men with that prideful look. Come on now. We know what the Bible says. In Proverbs, he had a proud look. Come on now. He had, come on out, a tongue that, come on out, that speaketh lies. He said, a false witness shall not be unpunished. The Bible says, men that has wicked imaginations in their heart. He said, he hate that. He said, hands that shed innocent blood. Uh-oh, that messy spirit. Come on, he says, feet that run, quick to run to evil. He said he hates that. How many people, come on now, when you see a whole bunch of people outside, you say, ooh, it look like, He said he hates that. But yet we have the audacity to look down, look your nose, come up at somebody like you got it together. You know your flesh is nasty. God says, he said he hates these things. The truth of the matter is, when it's abomination, he has every right to cut you off. That word perish, what we use lightly, means to be cut off. The truth of the matter is, God can why. The wages of sin is death. See, the truth of the matter is, but watch this. That old good, they call that good word called grace. It says that, that I give you life. Come on now. John 10 and 10 says it like this. The thief come to steal, kill, and destroy. But I come to give you life. That it can be called grace again. But we have the audacity to remind somebody of their past. But last night, come on, you know you weren't doing good. Come on, you were smoking that cigarette, smoking your cigars. Come on, you was up in the club. Come on, shaking it like a tail feather. But now you want to speak in tongues. You no good devil. Come on, the truth of the matter is, God says, I see it all. He says that I see the good and the evil. He said he watch it. He's come on, his eyes never sleep nor slumber. He's watching everything. He knows what's in your heart. Let's talk about that word iniquity. Come on now, every time you see a man, you lust and come on now. Your feet curl up. Come on now. The truth of the matter is, come on, you're a man, you get cockeyed. Because come on now, the truth of the matter, you're looking at every angle but the angle that you're supposed to be looking in, which is the angle towards Jesus. Because the Bible says in Isaiah 26 and 1, the Bible says them that keep their eyes on the Lord, not on flesh. And the truth of the matter is, come on now, you have the audacity to talk bad about somebody. The truth of the matter is, God says this. He says, I see your iniquity. Come on now. He says, you know what? He says, in the closet, they are full of dead men bones. The truth of the matter is, come on now, you got unforgiveness in your heart. Somebody done died, and you hate when their name be called up. Come on now, you got hate in your heart. The truth of the matter is, God says, and I still use you. Come on now, that's why the Bible says it like this. Them that are strong, come on now, should what? Bow and restore them that has fallen. And the truth of the matter is, we use this word holiness in a wrong term. Because I see a lot of holiness preachers that says nothing but a whole bunch of hoes. I ain't saying, but that's what the word says. You whoremongers. He says you destroy your own soul. But we go around talking about he did it, she did it. How about you did it? The Bible says that when David was thinking about bringing judgment on the men, come on, I know that spirit is in the church. Come on, because David was a king, a prophet, a priest, a daddy, a baby daddy, a husband. Come on now. He was everything. Come on, he played many hats. But the Bible says, he said, you're the man. You're the man. You're the man, baby. Come on, you're the man that messed up. You're the man, come on, that robbed me. Come on, that was an innocent man. And the truth of the matter is, robbing God of many forms. The Bible says in John, he said, you can kill your brother with your words. You speaking evil behind their back. You're gossiping. You're gossiping. You're backbiting. But you say, you know what, God, I love you. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13 that you speak in tongues. You know, it's a whole bunch of people that speak in tongues that play it real good. Oh, she be shit, thank you, God. You know, you ain't thinking about no Jesus. You thinking about what you gonna worth somebody. Thinking about what you gonna get into. Speaking in tongues. But having hate, bitterness, unforgiveness in your heart. Come on, let's talk about the church. The Bible says that when he comes back, see, we're so wicked, we don't understand. I know we always say that God is going to bring back a church that we are going to present ourselves as you know, faultless without blemish. But that's not what the word says. The word said like this. He said he's going to present to himself a glorious church. He ain't going to take that flesh. I'm sorry, y'all are holding, you know, old memories with grandmas and granddaddies and different ones and kids and different things and saying, I can't wait to see them in heaven, but that's not what the word says. The word says it's going to be ashes for ashes. When they die, come on, young, that ain't them no more. The truth of the matter is, we have taught a lot of religion and not the word. Come on, young, we have made the word of God none effect. The Bible says it like this, we want to be as angels. Come on, young, the scripture says that they asked this. They said, you know what, if I married this person and this person cheated or died, the Bible says, would that be my husband? Would that be my wife? Jesus said, no. He said, you're going to be as angels. What did that mean? That means that, come on now, that same person that you used to know ain't going to be them no more. Why? Because God says that he's going to present to himself a track without spot, wrinkle, or blemish. And the truth of the matter is, this goes back to the dispensation of grace. Don't let we use his word in the wrong way. When the Bible says in Revelations, come on out, if you speak of his word, you add or you take away. He said, if you take away here, take your name out of the book. Come on, that's what grace is doing in this millennium. That's what grace is doing in this dispensation. Come on out, the truth of the matter is, you should be cut off because you don't even know his word. Come on, but his word, come on out, it declares who he is. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. But we say we're his child, but we don't even know his word. He said, you know what? He said, you saying that you're mine, but I can't see no word in you. I see a lot of gospel, not gospel, but gossip. Spreading the bad news rather than the good news. Spreading the news, come on now, that happened to could have been you. Hallelujah. God says that this dispensation of grace was not given unto us to be boastful. This dispensation of grace was not to be boastful. Because God has brought up a big screen. Some of y'all will be tiptoeing out of here saying, oh, God, that wasn't me, but God, why you got to put me in front of you like that? Come on, let's be real. You know you ain't did everything right. In other words, this is why God saved me, so I can save you. He didn't save me so I can act all dignified and act like a Pharisee, a Sadducee. Come on now, one of the religious leaders that killed my master. He didn't save me to say, come on now, to keep the commandments. But he saved me to learn how to live. Come on now, and don't trespass against my neighbor. Come on now, that's the reason that he died. You don't study to preach, but you study to live. I said, God, why you say that? He said, because men should live by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. That's why. Come on, you study. You study to live. The only way that you're going to live is through his word. Unless the word abide in you, you don't have life. Come on, why? Because sin, it counsels. It counsels your birthright will be for eternity.
Mommy.
Yet, we have this religious thing, this religious spirit.
Yes, Mama.
Because we sing in the praise team. We go out to the ones that we used to do. And come on now, we act like we are better than this. We play the keyboard. Come on now, we act like, come on now, we got it all together. Come on now, but when they look at the inside, they see you messing up. Come on now, just like them. Agrippa, me and Pastor McGowan was talking about this the other day. Agrippa, he said, you know, you almost persuaded me. The truth of the matter is, come on now, it's a lot of almost persuasions in this house. But it's time for us to get it right. The truth of the matter is, God says, I don't look at the outward, but I look in the inner. I look in the soul. Do I see myself? Come on, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then when he created the heavens and the earth, the Bible says he moved from the face of the deep. So what does that mean? That means that he knows them deep things that nobody don't know about. He searches the deep things of the heart. The truth of the matter is, the Bible says it like this. The Bible says that he told Peter, he said, you must launch out into the deep. Come on, that is the same deep that was found in Genesis. That water. Come on, the truth of the matter is, before you was born in your mother's womb, he said that you was already there. Why was you already there? Because the word form means to exist. But he says, not only will you exist, but he says, I will give you life. Notice the scripture. The Bible says that the blood flow was for remission of sins, which means this, that there was a prudence before there was a now. And the truth of the matter is, we're living in a now, tripping over the now. But come on now, God says, yeah, I know that they jacked up. I know that, come on now, they ain't doing right. But the truth of the matter is, I see the prudence of their character. I see their we're fighting kids and saying, I don't know where they got that mess from. Quit lying. You were 14, you were doing the same thing. I don't know where they picked that mess up. Woo, that child. We asked one simple question, how old were you when you had them? A lot of people be tiptoeing. Oh. But we want to say that the preacher's bad. What's on your resume? The Bible says in Ephesians 3 and 2, he said, and it was given to me for you. This is the reason that we are saved, to win the lost sheep of Israel. This is why we are saved. To win the lost sheep of Israel. Have compassion. Like, Mom, you got a compassion. I love you. I thank God for you. Just a sweetheart. I thank God for her. I see it all over her. She be like, oh, baby, just keep on living. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible says that for that by revelation he made known to me the mystery as I have briefly written already. Already. Remember, preaching has never been, this is what God had me to hear. Because you know, the truth of the matter is God don't want for you to study to preach. Because the Bible says when Jesus was teaching the disciples, he said this. He says, don't premeditate what to say, for the Holy Spirit will give you what to say in that very hour. But we do it wrong.
That's right.
We teach people that you're supposed to go out and read the subject and get together. But that's where we become religious, because now it's no longer his house, it's our house. Mm-hmm. It's no longer about God, it's about what we want to give to the people. We got that soul mentality. Well, the people wanted that. We got that soul mentality. We don't do what God said to do. We do what we want to do. God don't want for us to be that way. He wants for us to be more in love with him than our own degrees, diplomas, and everything else that we have, our statuses. He don't want for us to love our status more than we love him. Sometimes we fall in love with ourselves more than we do with him. I don't say that it's not true, because the Bible said in the last days, many people are going to be lovers of themselves. Let's talk about that spirit of masturbation. Nobody don't want to talk about it.
Talk about it.
In the restroom, dark at night, listen to Al Green. I'm tired of being alone. But I ain't going to tell nobody. Hallelujah. We got to get right. This is what the revival, you know, that when the children of Israel asked for revival, it went for a house and a car. Oh, God is getting ready to move. No, God was moving before that person even was in the earth realm of what we call the visibility, where I can see you, I can look at you, and I can see your flesh. God was already being God in the earth realm. Isaiah 43 says that there is no God like me. There is no other that can compare to me. But we think it's all about the preacher nowadays. It's not about the preacher. I heard the pastor say, it's about God. The reason that God can always use the pastor is simply because he has an humble heart. He's giving, he's loving, he's kind. He ain't worried about himself. He's not worried about his status. He's not like the rich man. He had a whole bunch of money. Don't you forget the pastor. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give God a praise. Yeah. Don't forget about it now. Dude.